Good afternoon, good morning, depending on where you're joining from, and welcome to, this is the last in our summer program of virtual seminars run by the Qatar Centre. So it's my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Adam Shapiro from the San Francisco Fed. Adam's going to present what I think is a fascinating paper looking at applying text analysis to understand something about central bank objectives. So Adam, the floor is yours. You know, the usual rules apply, I should say, for our audience members. So if you have a question, do please post it in the Q&A box. I can relay those questions to Adam during the talk, and we'll try and leave 15 minutes or so at the end of the seminar for a broader discussion. Adam, over to you.
Okay. Well, thank you, David, and thank you for having me. I'm in California now, so it's bright and early here. This is joint work with my colleague Dan Wilson at the San Francisco Fed. So Dan and I got interested in text analysis, say about 6 years ago, when we met a computer scientist by the name of Moritz Sudoff. Moritz was working at a company called Kanjoya at the time. He's now the founder and CEO of a company called Motive Software. So we were at a conference and we met Moritz. We started chatting, and you know, he was explaining to us how text analysis, it could be used to extract sentiment or emotions out of text. Dan and I immediately got excited about this idea. So we got to work on a first project with him, which entailed extracting sentiment out of newspaper articles, and we constructed a new sentiment index. This index turned into a paper, and it's now updated daily, actually weekly, on the San Francisco Fed website. So this project takes that same idea of extracting sentiment from text, but it applies it to individual preferences. So in other words, if you see something that you like, you're gonna have some positive emotions about that object. If you see something that you don't like, you're gonna express some negative emotions about it. So you can back out people's preferences that way. And we take this idea to the words spoken by FOMC participants at FOMC meetings, backing out their preferences or their objectives. So there's a broad consensus of what the Federal Reserve's objectives should be. In a lot of papers, you'll see quadratic preferences over inflation relative to a known inflation target and economic slack. And also over the period that we're studying in this paper, which is the mid-2000s, there's pretty much a broad consensus, even though there was no explicit inflation target at the time, that the inflation target was around 2%. So you'll see this in the board's FRB USF model. You'll see this in the New York Fed's GSG model. They have an implied target of 2%. And you know, here's a quote by Lars Svensson in an AEJ macro paper from 2015, which he says that the widely held perception of an unofficial Federal Reserve inflation target of about 2% over this period. So there's just fewer studies about what the Fed's objectives are in practice. There are, however, a few studies that back out FOMC preferences or central bank preferences by looking at the interest rate rule, or just changes in interest rates more broadly. So you can look at the Fed's actions, and then through a model, you can back out what their preferences are. But this requires actually knowing what the parameters of the model are. So you need to know what the parameters of the IS curve are, what the persistence, what the slope is, what the slope of the Phillips curve is. And there's just a lot of disagreement in the literature about what those parameter values are, and they could be changing over time. And you just need a precise model of the economy. So you have to be sure that your model is actually accurate. And then you also need to know actions by the Fed. So, you know, you have to observe interest rates changing. And, you know, we all know about the ZLB period where interest rates just didn't move at all. They're also constrained by the fact that usually they don't move the interest rate in large movements. They usually move it by around a quarter basis, a quarter of a point. So there's just not a lot of movement in interest rates, I guess, relative to what's going on in the economy. So the approach in this paper, as I kind of hinted at before, is that the central bank's preferences are embedded in the words that are spoken by the policymakers. So we apply these sentiment analysis techniques, and we're going to back out what we call a net negativity by FOMC participant and the meeting. So think of Ben Bernanke at the March 2006 meeting is going to have a net negativity score. We're going to do that for each participant. And then we're going to use this measure of net negativity, and this will become the left-hand side of our loss function. And then we can estimate the FOMC's loss function directly because we actually have a left-hand side of the loss function. This is what is usually a late variable in those papers I was talking about before. So we have to collect data on this. So we're going to use the public FOMC meeting transcripts, which are currently available through 2015. So there's a 5-year lag on these transcripts. So this is literally like a movie transcript. You know, you'll see each person speaking. It's the exact words that are spoken at the meeting. And then we parse these into 700,000 sentences, and we're going to tag each sentence by speaker and the meeting. And then we're going to apply a filter. So we want to get rid of some of the noise. So we're going to drop sentences with less than 5 words. We're going to drop what we call standalone sentences. Sometimes there's just an interjection of a sentence that probably doesn't have much economic meaning. And then we're also going to drop sentences without any economic content. So we use the Oxford Dictionary of Economics. This turned out to be very few. Most of the sentences that they're saying have something to do with economics or some sort of financial concept. And then importantly, we're only going to look at the text by FOMC members. So almost the first half of an FOMC meeting is the board staff talking about what's going on in the economic situation. So this is really just about, you know, getting the sentiment of the FOMC speakers. And then we're going to aggregate all of these speaker meeting level observations, or these sentences into speaker meeting level observations. And this is going to yield about 1,700 observations between our main years, between 2000 and 2011. We did do extension analysis after 2011, which I'll, if I have time, hopefully we'll get to that. And then we also collected minutes for additional analysis.
Okay,
so we have all of this text that we've collected and we've filtered. And then the next question is, how do we extract the sentiment out of this text that we have? So we have all these spoken words, we have Ben Bernanke's text, we have Janet Yellen's text. So what we're going to use is what's called a lexical approach, in which you look at a predefined dictionary. So in these dictionaries, each word is already set by a human in terms of what its emotive content is. So the word bad is a negative word, and the word good is a positive word. The issue comes in when you're looking at a financial text. So there's a lot of funny words in economics that don't have the same tone or a sentiment as they do in just everyday parlance. So there's a paper that's now at 10 years old, the Journal of Finance, by Lofgren and McDonald. And here they basically take a dictionary and refine it so that it's more in line with economic parlance. So the word liability, for instance, you know, would have a negative connotation in everyday parlance, but in finance, that's just a neutral noun. So you'd want to negate any sentiment from that word. And then what we do is we're just going to do something very simple. So this part of the paper is quite simple. We're just going to calculate a net negativity construct, which is just the fraction of negative words by speaker I at meeting T minus the number of positive words divided by the total number of words. And this NIT is going to become the left-hand side variable in our loss function regressions. So here's an example of some text. So this is words spoken by Federal Reserve President William Poole, St. Louis, he's St. Louis Federal President then, at the January 2008 meeting. In red are words where Lofgren and McDonald have called them a negative word. In green are positive words. And what you'll see here too, like on that third sentence where it says not disastrously slow, we negate the word slow because it has the word not in front of it. So we basically neutralize words if there's some sort of negative word in front of it. And you can see also here, this is what I want to show, is that this dictionary method doesn't work precisely well. So you'll see midway through, you'll see the sentence earnings were up sharply. And LM, I'm going to call them LM from now on, call this a negative phrase, even though that's clearly representing something positive. Earnings were up sharply. And then you'll see down below too, third from the bottom, says the biggest problem is finding software engineers. So that's actually a good problem in terms of the economy, but it's listed as a negative word. But more or less, if you look through this example, it does a reasonably good job at picking up positive and sentiment, or positive and negative tone. So what we did was we wanted to make sure that this was working before we did any further analysis. We wanted to make sure that the LM dictionary matched what a human would see in those words. So being at the Fed, we have access to a lot of young minds. Our research assistants, we have about 18 research assistants at a time. At this time, we had 15 RAs score about 10% of the speaker meeting observations. And we just told them, okay, here's a piece of text. Can you score it on a scale of 1 to 10 from least to most negative? And then we lined up those scores with what the computer algorithm spit out, the LM. And you can see here are the results here. So there is a bit of noise, but on average, there's a strong correlation. It's 0.4, and the t-stat on this is very high. As we showed in our other paper with Moritz, it's very hard to get this correlation above 0.45, even if you use the most advanced machine learning techniques or other techniques. It just becomes harder and harder to push the envelope. And we also showed in that paper that this that the lexical approach that we're using here does a very good job at what I would call a very low cost, and that the more sophisticated machine learning methods take up a lot of time. So in that sense, using a lexical method like this is more efficient. So I think I'll stop for a second now just to see if there's any questions before I keep going. If not,
are there any questions from anyone in the audience? I don't think there's any in the Q&A.
Okay.
I think you've been perfectly clear, Adam. So why don't you continue? Oh, sorry.
Okay.
There's one immediately.
Okay. Oh, do I just click on that? Or are you reading?
I'll read it to you.
Okay, so, sure.
This is a question from Ulrich Fritz.
Okay.
Sorry if I've mispronounced your name. But the question is there a possibility that your loss function is asymmetric? Do you assume a priori asymmetric loss function for your analysis?
That's a good question. Yeah. So, we actually assume both. So we do two different estimations that I'm going to get to soon, where we do a symmetric and an asymmetric. The symmetric method I'll show you is much faster and more tractable. When you're assuming an asymmetric function, you have to, use a computer iteration method to solve it.
Very good. Looks like I think that's. Oh, there is another one as well.
Okay.
Thing when you invite questions, they
yeah, no, of course, no, that's why I asked. Yeah, great.
So this is a question from Raghav Mathieu, who asks, just to clarify, there's a scale for net negativity from very negative to slightly negative to neutral to slightly positive. So I think he's just interested in, does your scale run from negative to positive? And if you could say a little bit more about that.
Yeah, it does scale. Yeah, so let me just go back just to make that more clear. So yeah, so this is our score here. So it's literally just the fraction of the negative. It's the net, that's why we're calling it net negativity. So it's just a count of the negative words minus the positive words divided by total. So that's just going to scale from negative one to positive one. Yeah.
I see. Okay, yeah. Let's take one more, it's another clarification. So Gulch and Ozcan asks, how would the algorithm assess the word slow in the sentence pass through to inflation is slow? So that's maybe another one that could be ambiguous.
Yeah, very good question. So yeah, I'm going to get to that as well, because there is a problem when you get to what we call fact phrases. So what that question was getting at, like if there's a fact phrase, you're not expressing sentiment, you're just expressing something about the economy. So GDP was running slow, or, you know, so we're going to do a robustness test where we try to filter out those fact phrases as well.
Well, okay.
Yep.
Why don't you continue? Thanks.
Okay. I'll keep going, because a lot of these questions, you know, are perhaps being answered in the next part of the paper or next part of the presentation. So here's the visualization of our sentiment scores over time. So these are the time dummies when we run a regression on speaker fixed effects, which controls for speakers coming in and out of the sample. And this was nice to see, because it shows what we would expect. In recessions, you see net negativity increasing, and in booms, you see it falling. Interestingly, you see it actually peak in the financial crisis, which you'd expect, but it also went up a lot higher than we had expected in the dot-com boom and bust period of the early 2000s. Okay, so we're going to start with a standard short-run loss function. This is basically taken from the literature. Pi star here is the Fed's inflation target. And now we can generalize and say, okay, we have the inflation target squared, and then we have everything else that could possibly be in the loss function. It's not just slack, you know, since we're running an empirical study, it doesn't have to be just one variable, you know, it could be many variables, anything you have observational data on. So that's omega x. And now what we're going to do is we're going to take this loss function, and we're going to assume that each person has their own loss function. So that's the subscript I, and we're going to assume that the data that we have, NT, is proportional to LT by this constant delta, and we're going to put in speaker fixed effects, which, as I said earlier, this controls for the fact that you might not have the same speakers in the sample any one time, because FOMC members come in and they come out of the group. And now we're going to expand this. So this is kind of the trick here, is that when you just expand this out, pi star will go into this parameter theta. It'll also go into the fixed effect. But what's nice here is that you can just back out pi star just from the parameters on pi t and pi t squared. So it doesn't even depend on the constant here. So this is going to be a U-shaped function with a minimum of negative theta divided by 2 times delta. So this is how you estimate the symmetric curve. So we're going to use data from the Green Book, which are the nowcasts and forecasts produced by the board staff. And then we're also going to use current financial variables right up to the meeting. So as soon as the meeting approaches, you know, you get the stock market value and all the other values like on the day before. You know, once it's after the meeting or in the meeting, then it's endogenous. So you don't want to use those variables. And what's important here is that these Green Book values are what they discuss at the meeting. So it's in real time. It's as close to the date of the meeting as possible. So we're going to use the sample between 2000 and 2011. This is when Green Book started to include PCE inflation. Before that, they only looked at CPI. And PCE is what they target. So we thought this would be a good period to start. But we do an analysis, which I'm not going to have time to show, that where we splice together the CPI in and look at what happened pre-2000. And we're going to cluster our standard errors by speaker and meeting. So it's two-way clustering. So someone asked about estimating an asymmetric loss function. So here you have to estimate pi star with a grid search. So what we're doing is we have a different slope when pi t is greater than pi star than when pi t is less than pi star. And what you do is you just go through different values of pi star. We go from 0 to 3 and we see which one is going to minimize the sum of squared residuals. And then we have to do a clustered bootstrap, which takes a very, very long time to do. It's a two-way clustered bootstrap. But what we found is that this way produces a better fit. So I'll show you here. This is a visualization of the three different ways that you can estimate this. So this is using the program bin scatter. So it's actually aggregating some of the dots together so it's easier to see. But you've got PCE on the x-axis and the net negativity score on the y-axis. And on the left here is the symmetric U function. And this gets minimized, you know, between 1 and 1.5. So this is without any controls as well. This is just to get a visualization of what we're doing. So we're looking for the point where the net negativity is minimized. In panel B is a symmetric V. So it's estimated in the same way I just showed you, but you just constrain the two slopes to equal each other. So it's an absolute value. And then in panel C is where we allow the slopes to differ. So in this specification, you know, panels B and C look more or less the same. We're going to use panel B as our main specification just because we did get a better fit. But I'll show you estimates from A and C as well. Okay. So these are the three regressions with our full set of controls here. So column one is the symmetric U. Column two, which is labeled by accident, column one is the symmetric V. And then column three is the asymmetric V. And I can go through the controls as well. So we're including a measure of slack and its squared term. We're including GDP growth, which is delta YT. So these are taken from the Green Book. So this is actually a measure of the nowcast of the Green Book measure. And then we include financial variables as well. So the S&P return over the last 3 months before the meeting, the Shiller PE ratio, which is a level, which is a measure of the level of the stock market, VIX uncertainty, and then short-term yield volatility. And this is to get at an interest rate smoothing term. So if the Fed doesn't like strong interest rate movements, then they won't like implied volatility for short run rates. So at the bottom here, we show the implied measure of pi star. In the symmetric case, we get it at around 1.7. In the symmetric V, we get 1.5. And in the asymmetric V, we get around 1.3, 1.4. So all these measures are below 2, hovering around 1.5. And also interestingly, we see that the measure of slack is coming out insignificant. This seemed to be a pretty robust finding across a whole different slew of specifications. And the S&P return always came out very significant. So, you know, the FOMC participants get really upset when the stock market falls, even holding everything else constant. And this has been shown in other papers as well. So there's a paper, I believe, in the Journal of Finance by Cieslak and Missing Jorgensen, showing the same, that, you know, FOMC participants really pay strong attention to the stock market and other financial variables. So there's a lot of different tests that we do in the paper. You know, due to time, I can't show all of them, obviously, but I thought this was something people might want to see. Especially there was a question, so I'm now glad I'm showing this. So if we're focused on the inflation target, you know, maybe we can just look at that text that just talks about inflation, right? I mean, we can pick and choose any text we want to talk about. So we did that. We also wanted to get at statements that were about someone's opinion rather than fact. If someone just, you know, someone asked a question earlier. So we tried two different methods here. Our first method was to keep only those remarks where we saw a pronoun in there. So a word with a pronoun is more likely to express an opinion if you have the word I or we. And then another method is that we just tried to isolate fact phrases. So inflation had declined last month. The LM dictionary would say that was having negative tone. So there was a method that we have in the paper where we tried to isolate those and get rid of them. And then also in terms of, you know, we're looking at central bank parlance, which is different than a financial text parlance. So there are words like a quantitative easing, which is just a noun in central bank parlance, where you wouldn't want to presuppose that there's any sentiment on that. So we went through and isolated those as well. So this is just a robustness test. And you can see, first off, our results don't change much, which is a good thing. I will point you to column 3 first, which is the inflation text. This is just where we isolated just those phrases where there was an inflation term in there. And the target at the bottom, you can see, is around 1.5. So this is all the symmetric V shape. You can see that by looking at the absolute value in the first column. It's absolute value of pi t minus pi star. Column 5 is the opinion text they just talked about, where there's a pronoun. Column 6 is the area where we got rid of fact phrases. And then column 7, we call the adjusted LM, is where we got rid of terms that were in central bank parlance that you wouldn't want to apply any tone to that. So these didn't quite matter at all in terms of getting at a robust estimate. Okay, so I'm going to stop again because now I'm going to get to the second part. I can take one or two questions before I keep going again.
Well, okay, so if you have a question, please put it in the Q&A box. I actually missed one from earlier, I'm afraid. Okay. So relay that to you immediately. So this is a question from Eleni Calamara, who asks, have you tried any other economics-orientated dictionaries like Correa et al? I guess that's that Fed study that looks at financial stability reports and applies a dictionary to that. Do you want to answer that one first?
Yeah, sure. So we did not apply that specific dictionary. We did look at the Harvard Dictionary. That produced pretty poor results. We also did a different technique altogether, which is Vader, which is a rules-based algorithm. I don't show the results there, but that gave us similar results as well. But yeah, we chose the LM Dictionary mainly because it seemed to be a priori the most suitable for this type of text. But you could imagine refining that. So, you know, we did a little bit of that here, you know, in that last slide. But, you know, I could imagine a paper that, you know, would take text and do an LM type method, in which you get a much more refined central bank suitable dictionary.
Yeah,
to do that. And I would imagine you would have to use, you know, you could, there's, you know, all different techniques out there now to do that.
That's an idea for the future, isn't it? A question from Wenbin Wu, who asks, could you explain a little bit more about the method for identifying and isolating these fact phrases? That seemed like an interesting point.
How did we do that? Yeah. Okay, let me go. I think I've got some. Yeah, okay. So here are the fact phrases that we isolated. So what we did was we took the most common, we just went through and we looked at the most common words in the entire text. And we just eyeballed which of these terms are economic variables. And that's what this list on the left is. And then we went through the LM dictionary and we said, okay, which words are directional words, meaning up, down, or something like that. And then we just paired these together. And so this is the union of these two, is how we got rid of fact phrases.
I see.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Okay.
Let me go back here. I'm going to ask you a quick one as well as we're doing this.
Okay, so sure.
I was kind of intrigued by this finding that it was the S&P that seems to show up kind of quite prominently. And I was wondering about, you know, your method. I guess it's like you explained it as a count of, you know, the number of words appearing. And I wonder if, you know, that's just such a prominent indicator. You can imagine it appears every time and people always talk about it. But they may attach not very much weight to it, even though it is featuring a lot in conversation as like an easy indicator to talk about. Does that concern you? I don't know if I'm articulating that well, but this.
Yeah, no, you are. It does concern us. So there's, I mean, different ways around that. You could go through and get rid of the S&P, you know, anything related to the stock market, which is essentially what we did here, right? Because we're looking, so column three here is only looking at text related to the stock or related, you know, to inflation. But then you could say, okay, well, maybe the stock market just kind of, you know, taints how they're viewing inflation, affects their tone. But then I would argue then it's important still, right? Because that's what we're actually trying to get at, is what, you know, the economy is a certain way. And then you're saying, okay, how are you guys feeling? You know, how is the FOMC feeling on this day? Are they feeling good or are they feeling bad? And that's the concept that we're actually trying to extract. But what's also nice is that even if you put the stock market in as a control, we're still able to estimate the coefficients on pi. So that's holding fixed any movements in the stock market.
Yeah, I see. Yeah. It's really intriguing, these low estimates of pi still.
Yeah, I mean, working at the Fed, you know, we always try to say we don't care about the stock market, you know, but it's hard not to. So it's up in front.
All right. You continue, please.
Okay. Okay. So now the second part of the paper is kind of looking at this finding of this 1.5% inflation target and say, okay, you know, is this interesting? And what does this mean for policy? And is this accurate? You know, is this 1.5% number right? You know, can we have any sort of have corroboration of this number? So what's interesting here is that this 1.5% number is below what academics thought it was, but it's also below what surveys show. So this is the SPF, the Survey of Professional Forecasters. So there is no SPF for the PCE pre-2007. So that's the CPI 10-year above it. And then you see the PCE SPF there in dark black, but you see that, you know, our estimate is far below what the public thought expected inflation was. And expected inflation is what policymakers view as what the public thinks the target is. So, what's going on here? You know, is the FOMC, do we mismeasure this, or was the public wrong about the FOMC and vice versa? So we have pretty strong evidence that the target was 1.5 and the public was actually getting it wrong and the Fed was missing their target. So, you know, you just have to look in the text. It's kind of all there. So this is a quote from Bill Poole again. And he said, I had several conversations at Jackson Hole with Wall Street economists and journalists. And they said, quite frankly, that they really do not believe that our effective inflation target is 1 to 2, meaning at 1.5%. They believe we have morphed into 1.5 to 2.5%. And no one thought that we were really going to do anything over time to bring it down to 1 to 2%. There's other quotes that are very similar to this that you can find in the text. This was just the most explicit one. And then the question is, well, you know, what does this mean in terms of credibility? You know, if they're just missing by a little bit, maybe that doesn't mean much. Well, you know, in the central bank, you know, 50 basis points is huge. This is a quote by Ben Bernanke, and he says, like most of you, I'm not an alarmist about inflation. I think the worst is likely to happen would be 20 or 30 basis points over the next year. But even that amount is a little disconcerting for me. I think it's very important for us to maintain our credibility on inflation, and it would be somewhat expensive to bring that additional inflation back down. So meaning that, you know, you have to raise interest rates, hurt the economy a bit to get inflation down. And, you know, they're willing to do that just because they've been missing. So, you know, we're going to argue that, you know, the FOMC was actually altering their policy because inflation they thought was too high. You know, it was above their 1.5 comfort zone. So they ended up increasing rates 17 times in the mid-2000s. So here's a quote by Michael Mosco of the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago. He says at the 2006 meeting, this is right in the middle of this hiking period. He says, with inflation remaining at such rates, we could begin to lose credibility if markets mistakenly inferred that our comfort zone had drifted higher. When we stop raising rates, we ought to be reasonably confident that policy is restrictive enough to bring inflation back toward the center of our comfort zone, which I believe is 1.5%. So for today, we should move forward with an increase of 25 basis points. So there's also other evidence that we have in the paper where you see them talking about the fact that they think inflation is too high, and that's the reason for them increasing rates is to get inflation back. So how do you put this into an empirical model? Well, you estimate a Taylor rule. You know, I kind of argued in the beginning that you don't want to do this because you don't know the parameters in order to do this, but we just did an experiment anyway, just to see, you know, does the 1.5% rate fit better with the Fed's actions than either a 2% rate or something that moves around, which I'll get to in a second. So these are just, this is just a very simple Taylor rule, estimating the nominal rate against an inflation gap and an unemployment gap. So we're going to use the Green Book values of the unemployment gap. For our star, we're going to use two different models taken from other papers. One is by Christensen and Rudebush. The other one is from Lubick and Mathis. We chose this because they're model-free. So the Christensen-Rudebush method is based on financial variables, and the Lubick math is just a time-varying VAR. And you can see that the 1.5% rate not only fits better in terms of the R squared being higher, but you also get the correct sign. So if you just put in 2%, you'll see here in columns 3 and 4, you know, you get the wrong sign on the inflation gap in column 3, and it's insignificant in column 4. And then in columns 5 and 6, we use this variable called PTR, which is the perceived target rate of inflation, which is used in the FRBUS model. And this is based on inflation expectations. It's kind of like a strung together measure by the board. And just a fixed 1.5% rate works better there than the PTR variable. So this is just some, you know, I'm corroborating evidence that that their actions kind of fit better with a 1.5% rate than a 2% rate. Kind of, I'm corroborating that text that we found. So now we're going to do a similar analysis where we look at the text and see if are there areas where or of the text where FOMC participants just say what their target is. And they do that. So this is kind of amazing because we actually stumbled upon this by accident and was like, hey, Dan, look at this. You know, these people are just, they're just saying what their target is. So here's an example by Mayer in 2001. You know, he says he prefers 1.5% rate for the core PCE. Here's Janet Yellen in 2007 saying, you know, she remains comfortable with an inflation objective of 1.5%. And then there's Mishkin, which has really funny quote. If you guys want to have a little bit of a laugh, you know, just look up all the text spoken by Mishkin. He's got quite a vocabulary. And you know, he's a 2% kind of guy, and he knows other good people who are 1.5% kind of guys, but he's a 2% kind of guy. And if you do this, you know, you can go through the whole text. Sorry about this. So yeah, here's a Janet Yellen actually changing from going from 1.5% to 2%. This next figure I will show you kind of shows that there was a change. So we did an automated regular expression search over all the FOMC transcripts, looking for instances in which they may have been talking about a target. So this was just a way to kind of help us find these quotes because there's just so much text. And when we did that, we found about 50 instances of times when FOMC participants basically explicitly stated what their target was. So in blue are times when the FOMC participant stated that they wanted 1.5%. Light blue is even lower, as 1. I think that happened a couple times. And then in red are the instances in which they preferred 2%. So the first thing I want to point out is there's this trend. You can see that there were hardly any red dots pre-2008 or, you know, even 2009. The only red dot really there is Mishkin, and we already know he's a 2% kind of guy. And there's Cohn also who had a red dot, but most of the dots are blue. And then you see, interestingly, you know, in the financial crisis, you see this shift up towards a red then, but there's still some blues there as well. You know, you see a Lacker in blue and Bullard in blue. Anyway, so there's two things here. One, it gives more credence to the idea that 1.5% was what the target was then, but then, you know, there's this possibility that there was a shift up in 2009. So in order to figure this out more broadly, we went back to the data and we split the data up into three groups of people. We have those people that stated in the previous meeting that they preferred 1.5. There are those FOMC participants that stated they wanted 2. And then there's all the others, which is the interesting one, right? Because those are the people that don't have explicit statements. So if you bring your eyes down to the bottom, you see that the 1.5 people were getting an estimate of pi star at around 1.4, 1.3. The narrative twos we get at around 2, which is good. So this is good because, you know, that corroborates what we see in the explicit statement and it corroborates our method. And then interestingly, the other members were around 1.5. So what this brings us to conclude is that, you know, there was this shift looking around up to 2 around 2009, but most of the FOMC members in this period were around 1.5%. So there was an explicit target that was formed in January of 2012. So this is why our sample ends at the end of 2011. And this is when a committee put out a statement saying that an inflation rate of 2%, you know, as measured by the annual change in the PCE, is most consistent over the long run with the Fed's statutory mandate. So the issue here is that our transcripts end in 2015. So we don't quite have enough. We'd only have 3 years of data if we wanted to measure a post-2012 estimate. However, we can go to the minutes, which are published up to the present. You know, it's a few weeks after the meeting they're put out. So the drawback of the minutes is that, you know, it's a summary of the meeting. So it's a mishmash of different people saying different things, and it's also highly edited by board staff. So you're not only not getting the words actually spoken, but you're getting what the board wants to put out as a public. So it might not be as rich as the actual data. And you can't control for the fact that there's FOMC participants entering and leaving the sample, which, you know, could affect your estimates if you have a really positive person in a meeting over a certain period of time and someone who speaks really negatively all the time at another meeting. And then the third issue is that we don't have data. The Green Book data as well isn't updated with a 5-year lag. So what we did was we went to Macro Advisors data, which tends to match pretty well the Green Book nowcast, not the longer run forecast, but the current variable information, it matches well. So that's how we were able to get the current information about inflation and unemployment. So this is really interesting here in that, so on the left is our 2000-2011 sample. That's just a reproduction of our main sample, and we got our 1.5 estimate. And then column two is our estimate over the post-2012 period using, this is with the minutes as well. So we were able to match the 1.5 estimate using the minutes. And then in the post period, we're also able to get good estimates. And interestingly, we get the 2% target coming in. So that was pretty striking to us. They still like the stock market a lot. That's still pretty significant. And the slack coefficient's actually coming in significant now as well. Okay, so this is the end of the presentation, but I'm more than happy to take as many questions as you guys want to ask. Just to summarize, we estimate an implicit inflation target of 1.5% between 2000 and 2011, which then moved to a 2% after the announcement of the 2% goal in 2012. These separate analysis of explicit statements also corroborate that there was a modal target of 1.5%. This started to drift up in the financial crisis. I didn't say this earlier, but one of the reasons probably was that in the financial crisis we saw there was a large risk of deflation, and FOMC policymakers dislike that risk. So if you have a higher target, if you move the target up, that gives you more of a cushion against deflation. So that would be one reason as to why we started to see that drift up in 2009. And then also interestingly, that the FOMC cares a lot about output growth and financial conditions. And at least in the first sample period, they cared less so about slack. But the financial conditions seem to come in significant everywhere. So, and with that, I will conclude and hope to answer any more questions that everybody has.
Well, it's fantastic, Adam. It's extremely clear, and it's quite striking how plausible the results come out. It's quite incredible. So please, now's the time to put your questions in the Q&A. Let me kick off with one I was meaning to ask you earlier. So my understanding of the transcripts that are released is alongside the actual kind of verbatim discussion amongst the FOMC, you also have like the staff analysis and the kind of notes and papers that are that feed into the discussions. I guess it's like a two-prong question. So are you using that as well to kind of extract something about sentiment? And if not, have you tried comparing like a staff version of the sentiment with that appears in the FOMC discussion? I don't know if that's even possible, but
No, it is possible. Yeah, so our idea was to get rid of the staff's text for the very reason that it's more prone. I mean, it's not the FOMC's preferences. It's the staff's facts, right? I mean, it's that they're just going to display. I mean, I guess it could include also any sentiment that the staff has as well. We have not looked at that, but that would be interesting, though, to see if there's any implicit bias or anything. I mean, so if that were to move in a fashion that wouldn't align with the economic data, that would be disconcerting for two reasons. It would say our method's not working very well, or there's something weird going on with the staff. So yeah, that it would be good to look into that.
Another question. Have you, so in terms of financial conditions, we spoke about the stock market that you've got, and I think you added the VIX in there as well. Mm-hmm. You also, I guess things like credit type metrics have attracted quite a lot of prominence since the global financial crisis. Things like the excess bond premium measure or other measures of sentiment in credit markets. Have you tried that type of thing? Is that available?
No, we try. The only thing similar to that would be the interest rate volatilities. This is the implied volatility on short rates, which we get from Glenn and Jens's model, using options, basically, where you get, you know, what's the implied, I forget the name, some Greek letter of what the option implied volatility is. And we didn't have much luck, you know, in terms of getting anything come out of that. So either they're not paying attention to interest rate volatility, or there's too much measurement error in that variable. But we didn't try putting in other measures of credit market risk, except for the VIX, I guess, would be something that would be proxying more or less of that. But yeah, I realize that's equities and not bonds.
Yeah. Okay, couple of questions from the audience. So Ulrich asks a two-pronged question. So why don't you estimate the Taylor rule as a forward-looking rule using instruments as part A? Part B is, does heterogeneity and preferences play a role, at least for the first sample individual loss functions that could be estimated? Why don't you take that?
Yeah, so there is a literature on the endogeneity of the Taylor rule. And I would argue, and this is kind of, you know, I have to balance this a little bit, because that's also part of the reason why we're doing this approach, right? Is that the Taylor rule is hard to estimate. So what we were doing in estimating it, you know, I agree it has some problems. There is a paper that was put out by my colleague, Fernanda Nekio, showing that endogeneity is not a problem. So they go through this whole list of our reasons why. But yeah, I would agree that, you know, estimating a Taylor rule as we did has that problems. Our point was just to show that, you know, if you are estimating a simple Taylor rule and you're just trying to look to see if interest rate movements are tied around a target rate, that the 1% or 1.5% rate works better. So the second one was about heterogeneity, and could that have a reason as to why? Yeah, so we did do some analysis about heterogeneity. Okay, great, here it is. Okay, so one of the nice things about looking at the transcripts as opposed to the minutes is that, yeah, you can observe all this heterogeneity and you can split these speakers into any which way that you want. So the first four columns are going to split them into, you know, are they voters or non-voters? Or that's the first two columns. So you might think that voters might speak in a different way than non-voters. We did get a little bit of a difference between these two. And maybe governors and presidents are different. And this was actually pretty strikingly different. You get governors have a higher target than presidents. And then I thought one of the more interesting ones was looking just at the hawkish versus dovish observations and hawkish versus dovish speakers. And you do see that there is a difference, you know, between these two types of a priori speakers. So we just took these measures from other papers that have measured hawkish and dovish scores. So yeah, there is a lot of heterogeneity between different types of speakers, but you know, at the end of the day, you know, the preferences are going to be just an average of those people. And that's what we're estimating at the end of the day. So, you know, was this a rise in the target that we observed post 2012? Was that due to the people changing, or was it due to the statement? You know, we can't be exactly sure. But our argument is that, you know, it's due to the fact that they all coalesced around this 2% target, and we're sticking to that. You know, you even saw this. You know, what was interesting too here is that, you know, even within the individual, you know, you see Janet Yellen right in the middle here. You know, you see she was a 1.5% preference person, and then, you know, in the financial crisis, you know, she even switched. So there's even heterogeneity across across the same person over time, which is interesting.
Yeah, I agree. That's fascinating. Okay, let's try a couple more. So I might answer these together because I think they're related. So Sammy Diaz asks, is consensus, which is known to be prevailing in FOMC transcripts, not hindering a better estimate of the global preferences at the Fed? I've given that right. And then I think it seems like a related question by Wenbin Wu, who says, is there a way to measure how speakers' preferences affect each other? That's kind of self-aware.
Yeah, I don't have a good answer to either of those questions, unfortunately. But they're good questions, and it's something that would be interesting to explore to see, you know, how that works. Michael McMahon, has a few papers on this topic, you know, about how a committee forms a consensus, which I think, you know, his type of analysis would be more suited to that. But I guess what you could look at to see is what's the dispersion of a sentiment, you know, which we haven't looked at in this paper. You know, how far apart is the sentiment over time? That would give you a metric of the degree of disagreement. Or you could just look at the text itself and to see, you know, is there more arguing going on in the meeting? And, you know, how does that actually shape? You know, it's just amazing if you just look at the text itself. You know, you don't even need a computer to do this. You know, you're almost better off just actually eyeballing it and reading it, and then coming up with a metric that way. But it would be interesting to see how that would look.
Yeah. All right, brilliant. Let's take a couple more. So I might ask the next one by, this is Juan Carlos Zambrano, who says, thanks you for a wonderful presentation, which is always nice. And he said, in a previous version of the paper, you considered Vader, I think you mentioned that in your talk, as the main tax sentiment method. Now you changed to dictionaries. Any particular advice as to why you took that route?
Okay. So, yeah. So we never had Vader as our main. Let's see. Do I have the Vader? Here it is. Yeah. Yes. So there was never a version of this paper that used Vader as our main text tool. In the new sentiment paper, we use Vader as well, and we looked at it. And so here's the result when you use this. So Vader stands for Valence Aware Dictionary, something. I can't remember the name of the acronym, but it's a rules-based algorithm. And what that means is that it's going to follow certain rules. So if the word no, I mean, the easiest rule is we actually use this rule. If the word no is in front of the word, you negate it. But Vader is actually built more around Twitter and social media. So it'll even say, okay, if you see a smiley face, you know, that's a positive sentiment. You know, if you have exclamation points, you know, make that, you know, more emotive. So it's not really suitable, I would say, for the FOMC text, but nonetheless, we said, let's just try it and see what happens. And here's what you get. You know, you do get slightly different result. You know, you get a target of 1.7, but, you know, we estimate it being still below 2%. And then you more or less get the same variable showing up with similar coefficients. So that was actually nice to see, is that, you know, it's picking up, you know, a lot of the same signal that we were picking up.
That's really interesting. I'm going to fire a couple more at you, if that's okay.
Sure. Of course. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Raghav Mathur asks, I think, an interesting question about whether there's any difference between perceived policy inflation targets from the public using data from like media sources versus this FOMC analysis. Is that something you've thought about?
You mean different? Yeah, I would say that question would be asking, you know, what were different? Were there different measures of inflation expectations at the time, and did they mesh more with what the Fed had at 1.5%? And Michigan is always higher than the SPF, just because when you ask consumers what they think inflation is going to be, they always overestimate it. So that would go in the opposite direction as the SPF. You could look at market implied expectations as well, based, you know, from a TIPS model. But I don't know offhand what that was saying at the time. But I guess the quote by Poole, you know, where he says, you know, he's just going out talking to people is kind of a good way of getting at it. You know, he's saying what the consensus was, you know, was that, here's this quote. Where is it? I can't find it. Anyway, he says, you know, I've been talking to, you know, people in the market and they don't believe us, you know? You know, that was actually really striking to us, is that the Fed was not doing, it wasn't hitting its target, you know. And I feel like if that were now, that would be more prevalent, especially because they have an explicit target, you know. So if they were missing their target by 2.5%, you know, so let's say they had an explicit target of 2% now, which they do, and if it was inflation was running at 2.5%, you know, that would be all over the news now, I feel. You know, you can even see that now with the inflation surge happening now, you know, and everyone's getting worried. So that was actually pretty striking to me.
All right, last question. Sure. This is from Petra Geratz, who notes that in your analysis, you're using these Green Book forecasts from the Fed staff, and this macro advisor's forecast as well. And have you also tried using forecasts of FOMC participants from the summary of economic projections? I forget when that begins to be available from, but what's your
response? Yeah. So that was the problem, was that the SCP was not available. I forget the exact date, David, but I think you're right, is that it's later in our sample. So we would not be able to use that. There's the same, there's a 5-year lag or even like an even larger lag for SCP, I believe. I'm not sure exactly what it is, but yeah, this was something that we actually tried to look at. I mean, there's a lot of information in the SCP, which would be useful. You know, there's a dispersion, you know, that there's their risk weighting as well. You know, you see, you know, are they worried about upside risk and downside risk? So that's all information that would be really useful to have in this type of analysis, but there's just limitations to when it's available.
Perfect. Yeah. Well, Adam, that was a really enlightening talk. Thank you so much for waking up very early San Francisco time to give this.
And thanks for having me.
The number of questions shows, you know, how interested the audience found this. So a massive thank you, and good luck kind of with the paper. And let me just say thanks to everyone in the audience for joining the seminar. This is our, as I said at the beginning, the last of our summer program talks. We'll start again in the autumn, in the fall. So enjoy your summers, everyone, and see you in a month or so. Bye-bye.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Adam.